May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower his special blessings on this very happy Eid al-Adha to all of us, inshallah. Eid al-Adha is basically related to the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, one of the great Ulul Azm prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What happened thousands of years ago is still being celebrated by Muslims. The whole process of Hajj is actually reliving the footsteps of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And for us, Eid al-Adha, even when we are not in Hajj, is in a way a celebration of the success of Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam in overcoming the obstacles in the way of submitting to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Taslim, you know, giving in to whatever Allah had asked him to do. And for us, Ibrahim alayhi salam is very close to our faith, because if you look at the name used by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Ali Imran, Allah describes him as kana hanifan musliman wa ma kana min al-mushrikeen. There was a debate among the Ahl Kitab whether he was from a Christian background or a Jewish background, you know, Yehud or Nasara. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that ayat responded by saying, Ibrahim came before Musa and Isa. So he was not Yehudi or a Nasrani. Kana hanifan musliman. Uses the term Muslim for Ibrahim alayhi salam. In the sense of somebody, hanifan musliman means sincere Muslim who submits to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even the religion that we have, we call Islam, actually this name Muslim to us was given by Ibrahim alayhi salam. The reason why we celebrate his success is because he is very much close to us in that way. Again, in Surah Al-Hajj, ayat number 78, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about our religion, you know, how he chose this, and then he says, what is your religion? Millata abikum Ibrahim. Your religion is the religion of your father Ibrahim. Wa huwa sammakum al-muslimin min qabl. And he has named you as Muslims even before Islam came. When did he do that? Again, in Surah Baqarah, there's a story when Ibrahim and Ismail, both of them, are building the wall of the Kaaba. After that, Allah, you know, they both pray, Rabbana taqabbal minna, O Allah, accept our endures. And there, Ibrahim did a dua, Rabbana waj'al muslimina laka, O Allah, make us those who submit to you, wa min zurriyatina ummatan muslimatan laka. And O Allah, appoint among our descendants, Ismail's descendants, a zurriyat, you know, the descendants among whom there will be ummatan muslima, a community which will be submitting to you. So even this unwan, you know, Muslim or Muslima for us as an ummah, comes from Ibrahim alayhi salam. So in a way, we can say that Ibrahim alayhi salam has given us our name, he has given us our identity. And therefore, interestingly, there are only two places where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about role models. One, he says, in the form of your own prophet, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in Surah number 60, ayat number 4, he says, and you also have a role model in form of Ibrahim. So he's saying, follow Rasulullah, he is your immediate prophet, but also look at Ibrahim as your role model, especially when we talk about this meaning and reality of Islam and Muslim, to submit to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does Islam mean? It's basically submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever he wants. And that is our ultimate test and trial. He has not created us as robots. He says, I made you free and I want you to follow the commands that I'm giving to you. And this is covering everything in your personal life, in your family life, in your social life, in your community life, in your business life, in your political activities, whatever you do. Islam is not absent from all different areas of your life, giving preference to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over our own likes and dislikes. It's not easy, we are not infallible. You know, we make mistakes, we fall down, but get up, continue, and Allah will help you. And that is the ultimate goal from beginning to the end. I said this many times, but I think this is the moment to remember that message. Our struggle in the modern times is what? I don't worry about the next generation becoming Christians or Hindus or even atheists. Although the atheists now are becoming very aggressive, they're becoming fundamentalists in their own way. You know, but that's not the challenge. I think the biggest challenge we have in the modern times as Muslims is the dilution of our identity as Muslims. Because a Muslim is somebody who prefers Allah's will and His commands over his own likes and dislikes. And that is the challenge. A person would still say, yes, I'm a Muslim. But in this matter, well, you know, I want to do this. I know Allah doesn't allow that, but I like it. You know, and that is the biggest challenge that we have during our time. And remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this phenomenon of preferring our own desires and our, you know, like and dislike against the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, actually, you have become worshippers of yourself. So it's not that, you know, the challenge of Christianity or Hinduism or atheism. It is actually we against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is where we have to realize in Surah 25, ayat 43, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَرَعِيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهُهُ هَوَى. Have you seen a person who takes his own desires as his God? He's using the word ilah for our hawa. Have you seen a person who has taken his own desires as his ilah and his God? That is the challenge. And this goes against the meaning and reality of the word Islam, which means to submit to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if, God forbid, a person goes constantly in this state of preferring his own, you know, decisions over the decisions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not take that lightly. There is an ayat in ayat surah 45, ayat 23, again, similar words in the beginning, أَفَرَعَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَهُ هَوَى. Have you seen the person who has chosen his desires as his Lord? وَعَظَلَّهُ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ وَخَطَمَ عَلَىٰ سَمْعِهِ وَقَلْبِهِ وَجَعَلَ عَلَىٰ بَصَرِهِ غِشَاوًا. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala realizes that this person now has fully gone in that path, and then Allah abandons him. And that abandonment by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ultimate failure. Where He says He seals his ears and hearts and puts a veil on his vision. And so this is something we have to realize, that our challenge is constantly to fight against our desires. You know, as I said, we are not infallible, we are not looking for perfection, but we should be attempting all the time. And if we work hard, Allah's tawfiq and help will be with us. We live in an environment where we believe in live and let live. But we don't appreciate the pressure that we get, you know, from the cult of worshiping one's desires, which is being forced upon us in our education system, in the media, at workplace, wherever you go. This issue comes up and up again and again. Definition of marriage, you know, the gender identity, all these are the issues which go against this concept of submitting to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything is being challenged in the name of fulfilling our own desires. And in such an environment, remember the example of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to be the true Muslims as He wants us. فأحسن الحديث كتاب الله العزيز بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الواحد الصمد الذي لم يتخذ صاحبة ولا ولدا وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله المجتبى وعن علي أمير المؤمنين وذريته المعصوم أئمتنا صلوات الله عليه أوصيكم عباد الله ونفسي بتقوى الله. Look at the ultimate test and trial that Ibrahim عليه السلام went through. In the words of the Quran itself in Surah Safat, which is Surah number 37 of the Quran, all the way from ayat number 100 to 110, where we see that during the old age, he's already 90 years plus. Ibrahim had no child. And so he says, and I'm just, you know, going through the translation directly, my Lord bless me with a child from the good doers. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we gave him the good news of a boy who will be forbearing, sabir. That's very much important for their imtihan. And when Ismail reaches to the age of maturity, he started working with his father, building the Kaaba. And during those days, Ibrahim alayhi salam saw this vision, this dream. And dream of a Nabi is not like ours. You know, when you have a comfortable sleep, especially as I said, after biryani, you see many dreams. You know, Anbiya, according to the ayat of Quran, actually there are three or four modes of communication that Allah has with Anbiya. And one of them is through dreams. Even our Rasulullah saw a dream. There is one or two incidents there. So Ibrahim saw a dream that he is actually sacrificing his own son. He saw it once, twice, three times. And so finally he says, because it was not only him doing something. You know, he is sacrificing his own son. There is someone else involved in it. And that's why you see this kind of hesitation or delay. It was the third time that he saw the dream. And then he says the words of Quran, O my son, I have surely seen in a dream that I am sacrificing you. Not like us, you know, you had to do this because I'm telling you. Ibrahim as a father now says, so ponder over it and let me know what you think. It's a very serious issue. So he wants this son to be with him, to buy the idea. Not just to look at it as a command. And Ismail alayhi salam, as Allah described him earlier, he says, O my father, do whatever you have been commanded to do. If'al ma tu'mar, you will find me, inshallah, among the sabireen. That is a serious issue, but I will do sabr in that. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then continues the story, falamma aslama. Again, the word Islam is coming in a verb form. when both of them is in dual tense here, falamma aslama, when Ibrahim and Ismail both submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Ibrahim placed Ismail down with one side of the forehead on the ground. And remember, he had, you know, put a fold in his own eyes, so he wouldn't be seeing. It means he was doing this qurbani for his son, but he didn't want to see that. And at that time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Ibrahim, you know, you indeed, you have made the dream come true. And then he continues to say, surely this is how we reward the good doers. And this is indeed a manifest test and trial. And so we ransomed and replaced him with a great sacrifice, where the sheep was sent from the Jannah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we preserved his praise of Ibrahim among the later generations. And Allah's promise is still living. Even today we are doing Eid al-Adha in remembrance of the sacrifice of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And so he ends by saying, فَسَلَامٌ عَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمٌ, you know, peace be on him. كَذَلِكَ نُجْزِ الْمُحْسِنِينَ, this is how we reward the good doers, and he is among our believing servants. So this entire Eid that we have is actually is celebration of Ibrahim and Ismail's success in submitting to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in totality, where the father is willing to, you know, sacrifice the life of his own son. Of course, that was not the intent of Allah. He just wanted to see the willingness. And that's where, you know, what we see in Mina, when the pilgrims go there, you know, they do the sacrifice as a symbol of the sacrifice done by Ibrahim alayhi salam. But there is a moment of reflection for the pilgrims as well as us celebrating that. Before the pilgrims go to the Qurbani on that day in Mina, they have to go and stone the pillars. This is a point of reflection that when you want to submit yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not going to be easy. There will be many, many obstacles and hurdles in your way. You know, these pillars which symbolize the shaitan, three places where he appeared to Ibrahim alayhi salam. And you know, when these deviating forces come, they don't say in a clear words. Sometimes they put it in a very, you know, intellectual way. You know, shaitan told Ibrahim, what are you doing? If you do this, don't you realize that the people who will follow you, the generations to come, everybody would be, you know, sacrificing their son? You are setting a wrong precedence. That's not the intention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, so it's not that he comes and says, you know, don't follow the command of Allah. He puts it in a very, you know, kind of a rational and logical way. And so when you look at this symbolism of stoning the three pillars in Mina, we're talking about the external, you know, evil forces and obstacles in form of shaitan and junud al-shayateen. He has an army. But remember, there is a bigger shaitan inside. And that is where we have to stone there also, constantly. Because, and that is the hawa, that is the desire. We have to control it, not that we have to suppress this totally. It is there for a meaning, and it has a useful purpose, but it has to be controlled and fulfilled within the dictates of the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have to do this constantly. Why not just stone the pillars in Mina only once? You do it on the 10th of Zulhijjah, 11th Zulhijjah, 13th Zulhijjah, those who have gone for Hajj. And you don't do it only once. Every time you have to hit seven times. You know, and this is where we get this idea of being constantly on guard, constantly being vigilant, and fighting with the obstacles which come in the way of submitting to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Since we are Shia of Ali, let me end with the example from a companion of Ali who died in his lifetime, in the lifetime of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And Ali praises him for about 7 or 8 good qualities. And he says in Nahj al-Balagha, he says, you know, you should try to acquire these qualities. If not all of them, at least some of them. And one of them is very interesting, relevant to this theme. He says that the good thing about him was that whenever he faced a situation which was unclear, what I would term as a gray area, it's not clear whether this is allowed or not. When we have this kind of situation, you know, I get questions. Maulana, is it haram in Quran? Well, Islam is not only Quran. That's Quran also says, whatever Rasul gives to you, take it. Whatever he forbids, stay away from it. So Quran is also telling you, go to the Rasul. Sometimes things are not in Quran, it is in hadith of Rasulullah. And the sayings of A'imma is actually for us extension of the sunnah of Rasulullah. And so when we are in those gray areas, we many times, you know, Quran becomes kind of a shield. Show me, is it there in the Quran which says it's haram? Well, not everything is haram in the Quran. And this is where Amir al-Mu'mineen says, whenever he found himself at a crossroad, in a doubtful situation, he would look at his own ego and desire. And he would say, okay, what is that I like? And then he will decide to go the other way. Because the other way would be the path of precaution, to make sure I did not give in to my own ego or my desires. And that is the Shia of Ali that he expects us to be. May Allah May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to understand the reality of taslim and submission. And that is the message that we have in Surah Shams, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when he talks about the soul of the human being, وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. He has inspired every soul with what is good and evil. قَدْ عَفْلَهَا مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. Successful is the person who keeps it purified, and failure is the person who lets it become corrupted. And that is the ultimate, you know, test and trial for us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you again on this holy day. And inshallah, you know, give us the strength to be among the true followers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma salli ala sayyidul mursaleen, sayyidina wa nabiyyina bil qasim Muhammad. وعلى أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى سيدتنا نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد شباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين زين العابدين ومحمد بن علي الباقر وجعفر بن محمد الصادق وموسى بن جعفر الكاظم وعلي بن موسى الرضا ومحمد بن علي التقي الجواد وعلي بن محمد التقي الهادي والحسن بن علي العسكري صلوات الله عليهم أجمعين اللهم صل على مولانا إمام زماننا وولينا الحجة ابن الحسن القائم بالحق المنتظر المهدي الذي ببقائه بقيت الدنيا وبيمنه رزق الورى اللهم ارزقنا توفيق الطاعة وبعد المعصية وصدق النية وإرفان الحرمة وأكرمنا بالهدى والاستقامة على دين محمد وعلى بيته الطاهرين بجودك وكرمك يا ذا الجود والكرم إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.